Good morning. I'm Harley Schlanger from the LaRouche Organization with your daily video update for March 17th, 2023. And let me start by saying to our Irish friends out there, happy St. Patrick's Day. Be careful, but organize. Now, I'm going to start with the shock effects of the so-called banking crisis as it's spreading globally. It's deepening in the United States, but it's especially big as it's starting to hit in Europe. The latest news includes a $54 billion bailout of Credit Suisse by the Central Bank of Switzerland. Credit Suisse is what's known as a SIFI, a systemically important financial institution, also known as too big to fail. And that's why they're putting $54 billion to keep the bank alive. Now, we also saw a big bailout of the First Republic Bank of San Francisco, which has a similar profile to the Silicon Valley Bank. This is known as a private sector bailout, is what they're calling it. 11 banks are putting in at least $1 billion each. Five of them are putting in, a total of $30 billion total. But four banks are putting $5 billion each. These are JP Morgan Chase, Bank of America, Citibank, and Wells Fargo. Now, why are they doing this? And this is one of the questions for the Friday questions. Are they just trying to grab the assets? Well, there may be an element of that, but it's much more profound. It's not just an asset grab. They're terrified that the so-called contagion will spread. Remember, Moody's, the rating service, just downgraded the whole banking system 2 days ago to negative from stable. And so these banks are afraid if there's not a backstop put in and not a bailout, then the whole system could implode. Now, this was the subject of doublespeak at a Senate hearing yesterday by Janet Yellen, a Senate committee hearing. She was asked, and this was a good question, what about reviving Glass-Steagall, which was the previous bill that regulated the banks going back to 1933 in the Roosevelt administration, which was repealed finally in 1999, which has added to the danger to the banking system because it unleashed the use of innovative financial instruments or financialization into the commercial banks. And this had been prohibited by Glass-Steagall. So Yellen was asked about this, and she said, well, there'll be plenty of time to consider whether regulatory or supervisory changes are necessary. She said, for now, I would like to see confidence restored in the soundness of America. What? Didn't she just say that the system is sound? That's what she said 2 days before. Now, she also said that the emergency rescue operations, including the fund, the flood of money that's flowing into the banks to bail out depositors, she said, this is not a bailout. Now, what's interesting is that in the case of the Silicon Valley Bank, they not only are bailing out the FDIC promise of 250,000 or less in depositors' exposure, but all deposits, which means the really large depositors who may have millions in their account, they're going to be bailed out also. This is not a bailout. Well, it appears as though Yellen and the Federal Reserve have taken the decision to save the banks, even if it triggers new levels of inflation. So we'll see how this continues to unfold. A very important comment from Paul Craig Roberts, a former Treasury Department official, who also raised the question of, would this have happened if Glass-Steagall were in effect? And he implied that it would not have happened. But he said that we're still waiting to see what happens with the derivatives bubble, which is something that Lyndon LaRouche had always warned about as part of the financial innovation, supposedly to hedge the investments of the banks. What Roberts pointed out is the big five banks, the ones that participated in the bailout of First Republic, that they're leveraged at an exposure of $100 for every dollar of assets. That is not sustainable. Lehman Brothers was about 34 to 1 when they let Lehman crash in 2008. Now, the second leading story I'll just touch on briefly is the diplomatic rebellion going on against the unipolar order. We saw last week the intervention of China to bring about a rapprochement between Saudi Arabia and Iran, which has profound implications for the whole region of West Asia, including the importance of a Saudi-Iran reconstruction program, which could bring in the Belt and Road Initiative into the region. Now, yesterday there was a meeting in Moscow of Syrian President Assad with Russian President Putin, where they discussed coordination, which would include Turkey and Iran, to stabilize the area. And don't forget that the U.S. still has troops in Syria. The U.S. is still involved, allegedly, in counterterrorist activity. But in the past, the U.S. so-called counterterrorism included arming what they called moderate rebels that included ISIS and Al-Qaeda. So the attempt to create a broader alliance, which would include Turkey and Iran with Syria and Russia, portends the reconstruction of Syria. And this is where China, with its global security initiative, can play a role. What many commentators are saying, which is correct, is that this leaves the United States and the United Kingdom, which in the past have acted as though this is their own personal turf. It leaves them on the outside looking in and reflects the moves away from the existing so-called rules-based order toward the beginnings of new economic relations as well as strategic relations. So these are extremely interesting developments, and they're occurring as the situation in Ukraine is moving into a more serious problem for the West, as even the Washington Post and Politico are admitting that Ukraine is short on ammunition and short on manpower. Now, let's come to your questions. I have a few of them today. The first one is from KJ, and KJ asks, what do you mean by speculation and what do you mean by rules-based order? Well, speculation is basically betting. You know, the idea was with something like Glass-Steagall that investment banks, you can put money in investment banks if you want to bet, for example, bet on stocks or bet on the new financialization where everything, commodities, construction, weather forecasts, all of these are turned into speculative investment opportunities. Well, what that means is that you're betting on some process that will cause a rise in the so-called value of the financial instrument. Now, many of these financial instruments are backed by nothing. That's what a derivative is. It's a valuation based on something, the value of something, but having nothing backing it up. So these are instruments that are designed to hedge so that, on the one hand, you're betting that something's going to go up, but then you take out an insurance in case it collapses. And these are now adding up to $2 quadrillion of obligations. Now, that's what speculation is. Instead, in a sense, it's when the risk goes far beyond anything that's legitimate. Now, if you invest in a new industry, a startup, or something like a modernization of a steel plant or something, you're taking a risk, and it may take a while before you get a profit. But there's something physical there. If you're betting on whether someone will buy a piece of financial paper or a token, which has no value in itself, that's speculation. And that's how much of the wealth of the billionaires has been made, by getting people to speculate on financial instruments backed by the banks, backed by the idea that a systemically important financial institution will be bailed out if it gets into trouble. The investor may lose some of the money, but the company that does the investment, namely the hedge fund or the equity fund or the bank, will be bailed out. That's what the neoliberal system has become, a gigantic casino economy. And ultimately, you, the taxpayer, bear the price for that. Now, on what is the rules-based order, that's a phony conception that was developed by the British and the Americans to say that you must abide by our rules. This is after the fall of the Soviet Union, where they said there's only one system that works, the liberal order of the West, the so-called democratic order. And if you get out of line with that, if you don't abide by our policies, we preserve the right or reserve the right to go in and attack you, to defend the so-called rules-based order. Now, there are actual rules, or I would say laws, international law, including the UN Charter, including the laws that were drafted following the Nazi period and the trials at Nuremberg. But these are internationally agreed upon laws that reflect some higher principle. The so-called rules-based order basically says, if you don't do what we say, if you don't elect governments that will impose austerity on your population to pay the debt, if you don't allow us to use your territory as a staging area, we can carry out regime change coups, we can dump, get rid of your government, and so on. That's the rules-based order. It's arbitrary, it goes against international law, and unfortunately, it's accepted by most of the governments of the NATO countries and the United States and Canada, the Five Eyes, Australia, New Zealand. And it's a travesty. It's something that has to be eliminated in favor of what really does work, which is commitment to international law based on natural law principles. Now, the next question is from Thomas. As demonstrations grow against governments, as we're seeing throughout Western Europe, will these governments send in the military to enforce their will? Well, we'll see. It's already occurring in the Netherlands at a big farm demonstration last Saturday, where there were 25,000 farmers and others demonstrating. The government ruled that no tractors would be allowed into the city. And they had a very heavy police presence, and some say a military presence, to make sure no tractors came in. In France, we're seeing fights breaking out between police and demonstrators. In Greece, the same thing. As the European Union rules are oppressing people more, shutting down their businesses, raising their prices through inflation and energy shortages, which are all artificially caused by sanctions and so on, people are angry. People are demanding justice. And under those circumstances, governments can either respond to the genuine needs of their constituents, or they'll have to suppress them. And we'll see what happens in France now, because Macron couldn't get his pension reform bill through the lower house in the French parliament. And so he decreed the law by presidential authority. And I think this is going to create a blowback against him and probably much larger demonstrations in the near future. Now, two more questions of the same sort. One from a correspondent in Des Moines, Iowa, who asks, why do Americans seem so complacent? And from a Canadian in Vancouver, I was asked, what will it take for Canadians to move against our pathetic government? Well, those of you who know what's going on know what the problem is. Much of the population has been beaten into submission, either by being indifferent because they have it better than they expected, or they haven't lost everything yet. They believe the media, they believe the lies of their governments, or they just don't take an interest in it. They just try to get along or go along to get along or get along to go along. You know, the famous saying from the Congress, from Sam Rayburn. So when they see things that they don't like, they may grumble to their husband and wife. They may, in a small circle of friends, say something. But if they see nothing that corresponds to their thinking in the media, that nothing that reinforces their views, they shrug their shoulders and say, what can you do? And some of them may believe, for example, that the banking system is not in trouble, the financial system is not in trouble, maybe Yellen's right, maybe this is much ado about nothing. Well, that's the attitude of the people who live in the valley of the clueless, who have been beaten down by the psychological warfare of the media and the government. Now, on the other side, you see this process of education that we're engaged in. We go out and tell people the truth and challenge them to find in themselves the love of humanity and the courage in themselves to go out and do something about it. And recently, we've seen a new process underway of interventions. My young associates, Jose Vega, Kynan, Daniel Burke, Diane Sayre, who are not only not complacent, but are willing to speak truth to power. They're out there, as my old friend Fred Unifeld used to say, they're rat-litten cages. And that's what's needed. You want to get people to stop being complacent? Get under their skin about how sad it is that they're willing to accept things that in their better moments would realize are unjust and dangerous to accept. So join us, because there's no solutions within the system, as Helga Zepp-LaRouche said 2 days ago. The system itself is corrupt, is crashing. We need to create new venues for cooperation. And this is what's necessary today. Don't bemoan the complacency. Be a burr under the saddle. Get people to start thinking about what it means to be a potent human being as opposed to a puppet or a serf. So thanks for joining me today. Go to our website, share these videos. One of the ways to break the complacency is to help us break the efforts to silence us. You know, Lyndon LaRouche was slandered for years. We need to fight for his exoneration. As many of you know, there are some days you can't find my videos on Facebook. But if you can't find it on Facebook, go to the LaRoucheOrganization.com, where it's always posted. But make sure these ideas get out. That's how to break the complacency. So thanks for joining me. See you next week. Hello, thanks for watching. Be sure to like, subscribe, and hit the notification bell so you don't miss any of our videos. Support our independence to produce videos like these. Become a member of the LaRouche Organization at thelarouche.org/member. By becoming a member for $25 or more, you'll get special access to the EIR Alert Daily Briefing and Weekly Magazine, which is what I read to stay on top of things.